Good afternoon, Friday afternoon. I'll be short. No, I'll give you just a little bit of description of our organization. It's called Orange County Coastkeeper. And though we're an independent corporation with a local board of directors, we're a nonprofit. We're also affiliated with an international organization called the Waterkeeper Alliance. It's based in New York. Just to give you a brief story about that, the Hudson River goes through a major river through New York and New Jersey. 20 years ago, the fish were dying. The fishermen were all going out of business, losing their boats. One weekend, the river caught fire, and they couldn't put the fire out, and it was on national news. The pollution was so bad. A group of fishermen got together and met in a guy's living room and said, okay, you know, what can we do? And they were aware of all the pipes that discharge into the river. And they basically said, well, most of their ideas would have made them immediate felons. But there was a guy in the room who was editor of Field and Stream magazine. And he said, you know, there's this thing called the Federal Clean Water Act. And in it, there's a provision that says if government fails to do its job and protect water quality for the public citizenry, then third parties can intervene and file federal lawsuits to do government's job. So these individuals decided they would start collecting evidence. And so that's what they did for a period of time. They put a boat on the river just to observe and take notes of what was going on. And they took their body of evidence to their attorney, and the attorney said, well, guess what? You guys are going broke, and so you're not paying me, so I can't afford to do this. And so the attorney suggested, he said, I just read in the newspaper where Bobby Kennedy Jr., who is the nephew of one of our former presidents and son of the attorney general, had just come to Pace University Law School in New York to be the head of the environmental clinic. And so they took their body of evidence to him, and he looked at it, and he went to a federal judge and got a court order that his students could, rather than play moot court in school, they could file real courts under his supervision. And so it gave him a body of attorneys. Long story short, 20-some years later, over $3 billion of penalty money from the dischargers have been invested, and the Hudson River today is the first American waterway to be officially considered restored back to its natural state. The fish species are back. There's still DDT problems, but basically it's a recovered river. And that kind of led the charge. A man that, his name is Frank Wells. He is the gentleman that took over the Disney Corporation, and he's the man that basically took Disneyland from an amusement park here in Orange County to the multinational organization. He also had a home in Malibu, and he would go ballistic when they would close Malibu because of contamination. So he met Bobby Kennedy and said, I heard what you did on the Hudson River. How do I get you out here? And Bobby's response was, well, you never will, but I'll show you how to do it. And so Frank Wells created Environment Now, which is a family foundation located in Santa Monica. And their first goal was to line the California coast like a picket fence with keeper programs. And so we got our initial start, a grant from Environment Now in the Wells Foundation. And basically, we've been operating ever since. But you know, what we represent, I can give you a long mission statement, but really what we represent is swimmable, fishable, drinkable water. And that's what this country deserves. That's what we expect. So basically, our laws are based on providing and guaranteeing and ensuring that we have swimmable, fishable, drinkable water. And our role then comes when that is impaired, that's impacted. And so in Harry's great, I love your PowerPoint, Harry. In Harry's PowerPoint, he talks about Crystal Cove, and you're going to go there tonight, I understand. We got involved in the early stage of the nonprofit, but before Harry came, when we sat in a wonderful lady, Laura Davick's cottage at Crystal Cove, and all of a sudden there was this development plan to tear all the cottages down and make it a high-end resort, but also across, when you go there across the street, you see what we used to refer to as 635 McMansions across the street that go all the way to the 73 freeway. The original plan of the Irvine Company was to drain all of that between the cottages. We used to call it Doug's Art Studio, and onto Los Trancos Creek, where it discharges across the beach into the water. And all of that runoff was going to come and just drain and go into the ocean there. We went to the Irvine Company and said, you know, we would like you to come up with a better plan because you don't have the right to do that. And you can imagine where that got. And so we did some research and said, well, the Regional Water Quality Control Board issued them a permit that basically said, you can come in, we'll give you a permit to discharge everything across the beach. And we went to the regional board and pointed out a law that's been enacted since 1972 called the Ocean Plan, which created ASBSs, Areas of Special Biological Significance. And we found, and I'm talking the year 2000, since 1972 to 2000, that law had never been used or enforced. And so we went to the regional board who's supposed to enforce it, and we had to explain to them the law. And so one of the staff members wrote the Irvine Company a letter saying that basically we're not going to give you a permit because of the ASBS protection provided in the Ocean Plan. And then Irvine Company flexed its considerable political muscle. Keep in mind, at the time, the president of the company, not the chairman, but the president of the company, just came back from a Super Bowl party at the governor's house. And so it wasn't a level playing field. So basically, a week after they flexed their considerable political muscle, the same staff person wrote a letter apologizing for his error in judgment and saying, come ahead, we'll give you a permit. And so we basically filed an appeal to the state board, appealing that. Also, only the very lowest part of that development that you'll see tonight, if you haven't already seen it, was approved. All the rest of the planning areas up to the top of the hill still had to go to the Coastal Commission. So we ran a year and a half campaign at the Coastal Commission. I flew up and down the state, met with every commissioner in their office. We had aerial photographs done, and we brought in consultants and showed the accumulative impacts of what that was going to do. And basically, the night before the Coastal Commission hearing, the Irvine Company took a head count of the commissioners and realized for the first time they were going to lose in the morning. And so the law provides that any applicant can ask for one postponement. So they asked for a postponement. And then with that, and we also filed a federal lawsuit against them for polluting and for the runoff coming off there. So between the appeal to the state, the federal lawsuit, and stopping them at the Coastal Commission, we finally got them to take us serious so we could have a conversation. And that's basically what it was and what it took to get them to say, okay, what do you want? And what we said, we've been fighting you for a year and a half. We've never once said you didn't have the right to build your project. You just don't have the right to pollute the ocean. And so once we conveyed that, they said, okay, well, what do you want to do? And we said, well, let's first agree on some engineers that we both trust and that are out-of-the-box thinkers that can really do something. And so to move ahead 10 years, they've built the Newport Coast. They've built all of their project out. They built Pelican Hill. And we've been involved with the design of all of their projects there. And I can say today that there's no, when you go there tonight, you're going to see the most sophisticated water quality management plans in the country. There's things that project has, and the Irvine Company stepped up and paid for, that still haven't been done anywhere else. And so basically, we took all of that runoff. We got it. Other than a rainstorm, it all is filtered on the site in big detention basins. Then it's taken to sewer treatment plant, except in a rain event. And then there's other mechanisms that automatically go into place to clean that water up. But what our view is, it's not just our activities at the coast. It's the whole watershed. That's why we have Orange County Coastkeeper. We also have the Inland Empire Waterkeeper. Because it Orange County, though when you look on a map, it's a relatively small county, even though it has 3 million people here. It's our county is more densely populated than Los Angeles County. We also have, with our watershed, we also have the largest watershed in Southern California. Our watershed's over 3,000 square miles. So anything that goes into that funnels through Orange County and funnels on these beaches. And so that's why we take on different industries who are polluting, and we try to clean them up. We at one point took on the, and I don't really want to just talk about lawsuits because we do a lot of education, and we're in 18 different high schools on watershed education. We do restoration projects. We planted kelp up and down the Newport Coast and down to Dana Point for 7 years. And some of our first test reefs out there at Little Corona, we have about 7 acres of kelp canopy, which we hadn't had in 30 years. And, you know, the importance of kelp is that it's the habitat to over 800 species of fish. And the fish populations, it's how fast and how resilient it is because how quickly they came back. We're at the Coastal Commission now with permits to a permit plant green abalone. Next month we'll have a permit to mariculture oysters and eelgrass in Upper Newport Bay. So we do a lot of restoration work, a lot of advocacy work. We're collaborative enough to where we work with the governmental agencies and the regulators. We actually write permits. The stormwater permits that the cities have to comply with. But one of the problems cities have is they have the good intentions, but they don't have the funds to treat stormwater and drain and clean up as water discharges. So in Orange County, we have a half-cent sales tax, and it was called Measure M. And Measure M basically is a half-cent sales tax that goes to support transportation. You see buses around here, OCTA, that's all funded by that half-cent sales tax. And they had to extend it. That was only good for 20 years, and it was adopted in 1992. So so they had to extend it, so they had to go back to the ballot. When they first extended it, it only required a simple majority vote. The laws in California have changed. Now it's 2/3. So they had to have it on the 3 ballots back in the early 90s. They had to have it on the ballot 3 times to get it approved. And all they were seeking was a majority. So now they were nervous. So they reached out, and we took polls. They took polls. Cal State Fullerton took polls. Chapman took polls. Everybody took polls. And all the polls said the same thing. Number one issue in Orange County was traffic and gridlock. Number two issue was water quality. People found it not acceptable to have posted and closed beaches. And then there was a big gap in the numbers. And then other traditional things like park and police and open space all came in much, much lower. So we, armed with that, went to the OCTA board and said, quite frankly, you need all the help you can get. Right now, we've talked to the 30 or so environmental organizations in Orange County, and we can't find anybody supporting Measure M extension. We also have read the draft ordinance, and it doesn't have the word environment in it. It just has, let's pour more concrete. And so, you know, there's things you can do to repackage this, but what we want is a fund for environmental cleanup. And it's got to be real, not just whitewash. And so we negotiated and we agreed on $243 million over the 30-year period that would just go to the cities. And it would provide money to the cities to put in storm drain inserts and put in screens and put in hydrodynamic separators to take trash out of runoff. And so we went hand in hand with the environmental community, the local government agencies, with the OCTA, even with the Taxpayers Association, and all said, you know, we want this. And there was no opposition. And on the first time out, it passed 68% of the electorate. So in 3 years, we've been developing a system. I've chaired the allocation committee. And we just a month ago spent our first $12 million to cities and the county in funding projects that basically are totally focused on just cleaning up. So that's kind of the advocacy, the collaborative part. But yet there's, and I'll be quick, there's a whole nother source. There's lawsuits is something that scares a lot of NGOs and scares a lot of people. We found that it's an effective and necessary tool in the toolbox. In our 12 years, I've brought 36 federal lawsuits against polluters, and we've won every one. But it's a tool. It's not something we ever use to stop development or something else. And I'll give you an example. Everybody in everybody's town, there's in the back streets of the industrial section, there's a scrapyard, a metal recycler in kind of a more seedy area of the community, and they pollute like hell. And we have yet to ever sample one in after a rain event or during a rain event where it wasn't polluting substantially. And so we thought, because the strategy had worked before, that if we took the big ones and filed lawsuits against them and put them all in federal court, that we would accomplish two things. One, would clean up that particular specific yard. But the other thing we would do is maybe convey to them a message that maybe their industry is time to clean up, because they're going to be more worried about us than they are the regulators, and because we're more expensive. So we kept suing them, and we soon realized after, I think, our 11th lawsuit, our 9th lawsuit, that strategy wasn't working, because that industry, unlike the development industry, wasn't unified enough. They didn't trust each other enough to collectively solve a problem. When they did get together, they just basically vilified us. And so I met a guy who kind of is the king of the hill, and I filed a lawsuit against him. And basically, he has 43 scrap yards in California and is the largest recycler in Arizona, Nevada, and California. And I said, you know, we went over and over the issue at hand, and I toured his scrap yard, and he basically had put in a fortune in trying to solve the problem, but hadn't been successful. He had bought, he knew we were out there. Everybody knew we were out there. But he had bought some equipment that was quite expensive, and it really wasn't working. And so I had him come to our office here in Costa Mesa, and basically we sit down and said, you know, considering all the money you've put into this and all how hard you've tried, I feel, you know, ridiculous trying to sue you, because, you know, I would say you're one of the good guys. You just haven't got there yet. And so I said, you know, why don't we sit together and partner, and why don't we develop an ordinance, a regulation for your industry, for the whole state of California, that will govern your industry. Let's give you a clear path to compliance. Let's give you standards that are achievable, and let's level the playing field in your industry. And so, of course, he said, okay, we'll do, I'm in. So we went and got the regulators, the regional board, to agree to a year process for us, for the industry, and us to sit down and develop a whole new law for scrapyards. And so we finished that in October, and all morning this morning I was on a conference call with everybody, because we just agreed before lunch that, okay, we got it, we're done, we'll support it, we'll schedule September 16th for the adoption hearing. And then it will be it's already being taken to Sacramento to be included in the state industrial permit. But it's something where the reality is if I'd have just gone to scrap yards with a nice big smile and a brochure and said, you know, I'm here to ask you to voluntarily spend $500,000 of your money to clean up your yard, you know, it would have been a matter of, can I run faster than the dog in the yard? And so it took that. It took the lawsuits as a tool to bring them to the table. And so... It is a very effective tool. It's an expensive way to go. One thing about our lawsuits, we never take money. We created a fund with the Orange County Community Foundation, and any proceeds from a lawsuit we have sent to the foundation, and other nonprofits can apply to that fund for money. It funds legal research and interns, and it funds if a nonprofit is trying to fight, because I've been there too many times, if a nonprofit is trying to fight to save some recognized resource, like a wetland, a coastal wetland or something, and you need to bring in consultants to do a delineation to prove, in fact, it's a wetland, this money will pay for that. And so we try to keep a balance of a couple hundred thousand dollars in there that other nonprofits, and we don't take any money. And my time doesn't even get reimbursed from a lawsuit. And so what we do is, from every lawsuit, we send the consent decree to the Department of Justice. They're acting as counsel to the EPA. and they review it, they call the parties, they basically certify that the environment was served by that action. And so it's a very important process to us. We do a lot of fun things, and yet we've got a number of battles going all the time. Desalinization, we're not against ocean desalinization, we just want it done right. And there's a proposal in Huntington Beach to do it wrong, using 60-year-old technology that has huge impacts. We're one of those organizations involved in the toll road, certainly Crystal Cove. When we got involved, I went to a meeting with Orange County Sanitation, which serves 25 cities in Orange County. And they were they weren't treating the sewage. They were dumping out a pipe to the national standard. National standard is secondary. And Orange County Sanitation had convinced everybody over the years that if they built a pipe long enough out there, because of our continental shelf drops off, that they could dump that sewage and it would never come back. And I looked in the newspaper in October of 1999 and we saw a public hearing and they were gonna go from 50% primary and 50% secondary, a blend of that to go out the discharge pipe. They were gonna move it to 80% primary, which is basically only strain the floatables, and 20% secondary. And I went to the public hearing and I was the only one from the public and said, aren't you going the wrong way? And so that involved a 2.5-year campaign. We had to go to every city council and get the city councils to adopt resolutions to their council representative who sit on that board. And finally, after a lot of fighting and a lot of wrangling, and we even raised money to charter a submarine to go down and photograph the outfall pipe, which is 5 miles out, 180 foot deep in the water. And so we wanted to change that way. And so when it came down for the board, after the pressure we had put on, they by one vote, we were successful. And they basically had to quit applying to the EPA for a waiver from secondary standards. And so now it took them 11 years, and this year they'll finish it. But $500 million later, we have not only that process, but we have what we call groundwater replenishment, where we have a state-of-the-art project in Orange County that basically just got the equivalent to the Nobel Prize for treatment. And we take sewage, we put it through 5 barriers of treatment, and we make it so pure that basically we have to inject limestone back in the water so it won't take the metal out of pipes. We take half of that, 70 or 35 million gallons a day, and put it up in our percolation basins in Anaheim, and it percolates down into our water table. Then the other half of it we inject with high pressure wells all through Huntington Beach, and we have what we call a saltwater intrusion barrier, and that builds a curtain so the salt saline water table from the ocean won't come in and impact our freshwater table. But because of that project and the water we're producing from sewage, basically we don't have toilet to tap, we have toilet to aquifer to tap. Because of that process, Orange County will never have a drought. And it's been so successful, we're expanding it now. And so there's tremendous opportunities for a collaborative process, for NGOs, for the environmental community, for those trying to fight for a quality of life. There's tremendous opportunities to collaborate and really make a difference. And again, we just happen to be for fishable, drinkable, swimmable water. Whatever you're involved in, but I would encourage you to really look at your involvement in sustainability. And I know I heard before, and I think we're all sick of that term, because it's just so overused, but I think from our standpoint, we encourage you to get involved in protecting the environment in your way. Thank you.